Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Rami Malek. Santa Barbara, Rami, and I will tell you, as Roger mentioned, this is my 11th year. I don't think I've ever seen a reaction like that here, so that's pretty special.
I don't think I've seen a reaction like that either.
Well, let's literally start at the beginning here. We're gonna go through these 37 years that you've packed a lot into. First of all, you're of Egyptian descent. Where were you yourself born and raised?
I was born in Los Angeles, like you said. Not too far. It's funny, when Graham King was talking to the band about finding Freddie, and Graham's British, and of course the band is British, he said, "Listen guys, I think we found our guy. I think we found our Freddie." They said, "Oh yeah, where's he from?" And Graham said, "Sherman Oaks."
So, growing up, maybe you can share what your parents' professions were, but generally, how did acting first enter the picture, and how was it regarded at home?
My dad definitely had the gift of gab. I mean, he would just, as a kid, he'd be telling us stories left and right, and we would huddle up next to him just to hear the next story, whether it was fictitious or not. He seemed to have done every career known to man. My mom was an accountant, and at some point my dad had, someone's hissing.
Yeah.
He was in a travel agent, and so closer, this closer. Oh, that's better. You'd think I'd know how to do that by now. He was a travel agent, and my dad was a travel agent. He saw everyone coming in from Western countries and saw wealth of opportunity. And at one point, he said to my mom, he said, "I know you're not going to like this, but we're going to take a chance on going to America and seeing what a different style of life is like." My sister was born in Cairo. And a couple years later, myself and my brother were born here.
Came along. But as far as acting, is it just sort of the usual school plays and stuff, or what was the introduction?
Coming from so far, they thought this is our one opportunity. The kids are going to be doctors or lawyers or politicians, something along those lines. And so, I would watch CNN with my dad quite a bit. I said, "Okay, I can go into politics. Let me take a debate class in high school at 12 or 13, and I quickly realized, along with my teacher, that was not for me. But they said, they saw something in me, and they said, "Perhaps you can do something called a dramatic interpretation, where you get a script and you can perform it, but you're still holding the script in front of you." And my teacher gave me a play called Zooman and the Sign, and it was about a guy that grew up in the hood, and he was, and his sister passes away at a young age, but somehow I felt I could articulate this guy's story at 12 or 13. I don't know what was going on. A few days later, I came in and said, "I think I can do this." He said, "Yeah, we'll keep working on it." I said, "No, I think I'm ready." I showed it to him, and he entered me in this competition, and I don't know where I got the courage to do so, but I invited my mom and dad, and they sat right in my eye line, which wasn't the best for me. But I had this moment with my dad where I saw him getting emotional for the first time in my life, and I was so taken aback. I continued to do what I was supposed to do up there. I knew it that much, but I'd never seen that out of him and never felt how it was affecting me in a way. And from then I thought, wow, if this is happening, because I picked up some words and strung them together in a way that someone thought they could reveal a message, or whatever was happening in that moment was something that was incredibly special and unique to me at that point in my life. And I thought, all right, I think we figured something out.
Yeah. So take me through the rest of schooling. Where, how did this evolve through that?
The very next day, I think I went to the drama teacher, Judy Weldon, at Notre Dame High School. I said, can I audition for one of your plays? And from then on, I started doing all the school plays. And then towards the end of being a senior in high school, she broached me with the idea of going to study theater in college. And I thought, that'd be a great idea. I want to continue or, do something with it. And I said, let's look at schools. I wanted to go to Chicago because Chicago had great theater schools. And yeah, and she said, listen, well, you can go to Chicago because one school from Indiana wants to fly you out and they'll pay for you to visit the schools in Chicago. And this was a school in Evansville, Indiana. I went to the Chicago schools. I didn't love them, and I said, okay, let's go see the school in southern Indiana. And we flew over Indianapolis, and I thought, oh, thank God, that city looks tiny. And then when we went to land in Evansville, I thought, the plane's going down, because there was nothing in sight.
And it continued.
And then I saw Merchant of Venice that night, and it blew me away. And I said, oh my God, I'm going to be in southern Indiana for 4 years.
So, like a lot of actors, after you were done with school, you went to New York. Yeah. And like a lot of actors who go to New York right after school, you were, not swimming in money at that point, not swimming in opportunities. But you had, I don't know if it's gall or chutzpah or whatever it is, that you pitch yourself in a way that other people maybe don't, and it actually kind of worked, right?
After New York, coming back to Los Angeles?
Well, right.
Yeah, I did every kind of black box play with my friends in New York and tried to make a living that way. It didn't pan out for me. And I met this great casting director, her name was Mally Finn, and she's no longer with us, but she said, come back to Los Angeles. Yeah, she's incredible. I love my casting directors. I would not be sitting here in front of you without the person that makes those decisions and allows us in the room and then champions us to directors and producers and has belief in us. So thank you to all of them. So Mally says, go back to Los Angeles. You grew up there, you know it, and I think you'll do all right there. She said, go get your headshot and resume redone and send it to every film school and any person you meet that you think might be able to influence your career. And I did. I went and every morning I was living in an apartment with my mom and dad and my brother and every morning I would just wake up and stuff these manila envelopes over and over again, take them all over the city, leave them everywhere. I mean, I was littering Los Angeles with all of these manila envelopes. And one day I finally got a call from a casting director and she said, can I speak with Rami Malek's agent? And I went for it. I said, speaking. And she said, does Rami Malek, you said, Rami Malek, you have an agent? And I said, well, yes, currently I'm representing myself. And she said, so you don't have an agent? I said, no, I don't, but we can work on that. And she laughed a little bit. And then she said, well are you SAG? And I said, currently, no, but that's something we can work on too. And she laughed, again. And she's like, all right, you're charming, this is cute, but you know, I'm sure it'll work out, call me when you get one of those two things. And I said, listen, I'm pretty sure we could get them both done today if you just let me drive 10 minutes over and meet you and just give a read. And you know, after twisting her arm for a few more minutes, trying to be as charming without being offensive as possible, she said, come on over, kid. And couldn't believe it. I drove myself to Warner Brothers immediately.
Right. And basically also on the same day?
On the same day, another cast, an agent called me, named Kim Dorr from Defining Artists, and she said, I'd love to see you, come in today. So after I went to Warner Brothers, I went in to see Kim, I read from the West Wing, I felt like I did all right. I got a call that I had a callback at Warner Brothers for the Gilmore Girls. Yeah. And the next morning, I got a call from Maya Rudolph, the casting director, not Maya Rudolph, Mara. Love her. Yeah. Mara Casey. And she said, you got the job. And you're in SAG. You're going to pay $2,000, which I didn't have, so I wasn't in SAG yet. But. And then after that phone call, I got a call that said I had an agent as well. Kim had signed me. And so my world just changed in the matter of hours.
Yeah, amazing. One more question before we go to our first set of clips, and that is, you know, so now you had your foot in the door, you had some momentum, but you then kind of discovered what hopefully has changed a little bit since then, but even just a few years ago was more of a problem, which was lack of imagination, especially for people who are not, you know, who have classified as minorities in one way or another in Hollywood. And let's just share some of the roles that you ended up playing that were offered to you and that you know, anybody in the early career is gonna pursue. An Egyptian king in Night at the Museum, an Iraqi insurgent, an Islamic American terrorist in an episode of 24, and an Egyptian vampire in one of the Twilight movies. So, these are big projects. You're getting, you know, your profile's growing, but it is my sense that this is not the way you wanted things to be going.
No, it wasn't. I mean, I looked at the auditions and I was like, okay, I know I can probably get the terrorist role. I don't know. Seriously, I mean, it's funny, but it was sad. I mean, that was the one I was like, okay, I'm gonna get a callback for this. It's the one thing I could count on. And then at one point I said, no, this is not how I wanna represent myself. I'm more than just that. And if I keep doing this, I'm gonna typecast myself. I will pigeonhole myself. And ultimately I said, I'm just made a kind of, drew the line in the sand and said that's it. I mean, if there's a role, I will definitely represent myself and my culture and my heritage, but it will be in a positive portrayal down the line when it really makes sense to.
I lied about that being the last question because I think that one more should be asked before we go to the clips just to properly set them up. And that is, I guess in some ways, the first project that saw the full potential or the beginning of the full potential of what you could do and was really a launching pad because so many other people, so many other things that followed came out of this one. And that is called The Pacific. It's the HBO limited series that followed Band of Brothers. And it was made by a couple of guys who, you know, are making a name for themselves in town, Tom Hanks and Steven Spielberg. And I would like to, come on. How did you end up working with them?
Ooh, that was, Meg Lieberman, another great casting director, she cast me in this show with Patricia Arquette called Medium. And yeah, remember that one? And another guy at Tom's company called Kirk Sadusky I had met, and he knew that I was a big history buff. And together, they got me in the room. And I worked so hard on this audition because I work hard on all of them, but especially on this one because it was the one moment I said, I'm not going to play that Middle Eastern character. And this was to play a guy named Mariel Snafu Shelton from Southern Louisiana, Cajun guy. And I thought, man, if I can do this, I mean, if I can go from, you know, one end of the spectrum to the other, then I can probably convince people that I can have a shot at playing multiple roles. I kept going in for that role, and I think it was Tom Hanks, that I think he started typing a letter to casting and to the producers and said, there's something about him that's haunting. Which I can see that there is something, but that's when I knew I had a shot in, and I kept reading, you know, another audition after another audition, as you do, and then a chemistry read with Joe Mazzello, the young actor from Jurassic Park, who ended up sharing scenes with me throughout the series. We got to a place where we were gonna read in front of all the producers and Tom at Playtone, Tom's office in Santa Monica with a number of other guys, went in there, and Tom had seen Night at the Museum, and I walk in very nervous, and I think he put me at ease. He said, oh, big fan of your work. And he said, loved you in Night at the Museum. Thanks, man. And I looked back at him, at Tom, and I said, likewise. And we proceeded to read, Joe and I, and usually, you know, it's Meg. I know Meg's casting assistant is a younger lady, and she wasn't there. And halfway through doing this very arduous scene, this really tough scene, I noticed that the casting associate is really good with the camera and is moving into the proper moments in the scene where they should get the right coverage. And it was an older gentleman. And a few seconds later, I said, okay, Steven Spielberg is holding the camcorder filming this for the audition. And I just kept right on going. The same kind of feeling I had when I saw my dad in the audience and said, keep going, get through this because this is going to be a good moment. And eventually it was.
So with that setup, let's take a look at Rami Malek in Night at the Museum and the Pacific.